The tune, the cat, weather.
Oh, it's not great out there, is it? I suppose it's dry. It did threaten with a bit of rain this morning, but those rain clouds should ease slightly as the day progresses across the northeast. We're talking 4 Celsius at the moment. We're going to get up to in between drizzly showers. A high, are you waiting for it? We're waiting for a high of 7 today. 7 degrees. Can you Christmas Eve it?
From Yarm to Yibby, Herrington to Horsley Hill, Swalwell to Silverlink, the North East Footy Breakfast with Roy, Steve and Ted.
Right across the North East, the red, the tune and the cat.
I think there's a very special start to the day today. Welcome to the North East Gardening Show. We are going to be talking today about what to plant and get your gardens ready for the spring, which is coming along. You'll have noticed the snowdrops are out. The tulips and daffodils are fighting their way through. And those succulents need a nice sunny part of the garden preparing before, of course, we get into the harshness of the summer sunshine. Boys, how are we?
Oh, terrific.
Brilliant, yeah. What a weekend.
Yeah, fantastic.
I just thought that was
enthralled to be here.
That little gardening world musical interlude there.
What a weekend, eh? Nobody's taking responsibility for the show this morning, so...
I did put it in yesterday, saying it was yours.
I've been away working all weekend, full of the lurgy, so I haven't prepared a show, right? You haven't prepared a show.
No, I haven't prepared, mate.
Ted, have you prepared a show?
Yep. Ted's gone.
Great.
Ted,
all right,
Ted.
Thanks very much for tuning in.
I did tell you before, mate. I asked you 3 times to turn your mic down and you haven't. I'm going to have to cut you off because you've gone.
Fantastic.
Call back in, mate. And then when you get that box of microphones, can you just turn it down, please? There we go. Great. He's gone.
All right. Well, I'll take control. I've got some stuff here.
Nobody wants to talk about football anyway this morning. So
Liverpool did well. Congratulations to Bobby Clark and the Clark family.
Yep. Nice little team of under-18s beating Chelsea's millions.
How embarrassing is that for Chelsea, boys?
Oh, massive. Brilliant. Massive. Very. Yeah. Yeah, Pochettino. Did you see Pochettino didn't shake the hand of the owner as well, Stevie boy?
Saw that.
Yeah, that was embarrassing, wasn't it? Embarrassing. Awful display from Chelsea. Fair play to Liverpool. Like, I mean, delighted for Bobby Clark. I've known Bobby since he was knee height or grasshopper, and you know, his dad was at Wembley yesterday to witness his son going one step further than he managed to go with Newcastle, and seen the photograph of the medal on his socials yesterday, and it was great to see. But yeah, delighted for Bobby Clark in particular. 2 Geordie lads, of course, part of that Liverpool setup as well yesterday. And it's good. It's good to see youngsters coming through. Young Ollie Harrison, who went to school with my daughter. He's at Manchester City now, and he's in and around the first team. 16 years of age. So you know, is the hotbed of soccer, you know, now starting to, you know, bear the fruits of, you know, a lot of hard work over the last 10, 15, 20 years. So it's great news, fantastic to see. And of course, potentially opens up an extra European place, I guess, for those people chasing, although I doubt that will be Newcastle after the weekend's performance, but I'm sure we will come to that. But yeah, I enjoyed it. It was a good 3 o'clock kickoff as well at the weekend. It was great to see that, you know, a bit of common sense from the TV companies. 3 o'clock in the afternoon, good old-fashioned cup final. And it wasn't the greatest, but good end of the game. And I say, delighted to see Bobby Clark bringing a medal back home at least.
What a sending off for Klopp as well, eh? I tell you what, Klopp, I mean, must go down now as one of the best managers that Liverpool have ever had. I mean, it's the most special sort of trophy I can remember Liverpool winning, just because of the kids. It's literally Klopp's kids beats Chelsea billion-pound bottle jobs. That's the headlines that you'll find on your Monday newspapers is Klopp's kids, and that's what's most incredible is that he played, you know, players as young as 20-year-olds. You know, Harvey Elliott, Connor Bradley started under 20 trio, Bobby Clark, Jaden Dans. James McConnell coming off the bench. I mean, these are all kids that they just needed fresh legs, and they were able to still beat $1 billion, you know, worth of Chelsea team put together, which is just a special night for them. Lads, we're going to talk everything about football, unfortunately, for our three North East teams. I don't Oh, no, please don't. No, it's too early. They've started.
And
no.
Is Ted back with us yet? Is he talking through a sock again? Are you there, mate?
I'm here.
Oh, no, he's turned it right down.
Hang I can't hear him.
Now, well, we are going to get some
about now? What about now?
Oh, hello.
Well, you sound like you're in a toilet. But we'll put up with that. Go on, say those immortal words. I haven't changed anything at my end.
Yeah, love it. Love it. Open Chrome.
No, what's
that's what
that?
You need to do.
As I'm trying to eat my porridge here on the quiet, so nobody finds out, but then I failed miserably. I've just spat it all over the microphone. I have to change that.
Yeah, disgusting. Love that.
Charlie's been on straight away, and he said, "Someone waiting for
morning,
the kettle
Charlie.
Someone waiting for the kettle to boil, lads, or is it three defeats you can't face?" Geordie Charlie in Cyprus. Who I'm sure Ted 100%. Knows. Ted, do you know Geordie Charlie? Oh, has Ted
gone
again?
Completely.
We're having. Earth to Cyprus, come in Cyprus. Is Steve there?
I'm still here, mate.
Oh, well, Steve's there. Steve's there.
Oh, Ted's struggling. Yeah, let's just get on with it, fellas. Let's just. When he comes back, he comes back.
Steve, I don't remember a time us doing this radio show. Obviously, we started, end of last year, that we come in on a Monday morning to find all three teams lost. I don't think we've ever had to do that before, have we?
No, there's always something, at least a draw. But I mean, bad weekend. Yeah. Bad weekend for everybody, to be fair. You know, I mean, I'm happy to start with Newcastle and get it out the way. It was, it was to be expected, I guess. You know, part of me, the optimistic part of me, felt that Newcastle could have, you know, with the players that they had available, you know, gone and got something at the Emirates, and you know, it was, you know, just the kind of. Kind of hope you have as a youngster, I guess. So, you know, it was misplaced optimism, sadly. Got off to the worst possible start and never really recovered. It was dismal. At times the defence, which was our, you know, strongest part of our team last season, is copping the blame, but it's the midfield that's letting us down. Sean Longstaff was poor again at the weekend. Lewis Miley's now suffering for having to play so many games as a 17-year-old. It's probably affecting, you know, his confidence and affecting his development at the moment, having to play as many games as he is. Bruno Guimarães has decided, you know, or been told, one of the two, that, you know, he's got to avoid this suspension, he's not putting a tackle in. So there's your three midfielders who, you know, are all going through, you know, some kind of bad stage of form, and it's affecting the game, it's affecting the team, and the back four is the ones who are copping it. As I say, they're copping the criticism from the supporters, but people need to look at the midfield. He made the big change, which everyone had been talking about, which was, you know, the left back situation.
Yeah,
he took Dan Burn out the firing line. He put Tino Livramento in. Some people seem to think Tino had a good game. I just didn't see it. I don't think there's anybody could walk off the pitch, you know, and say that they had a good game. So I genuinely felt that, you know, he had to make the decision after the previous week. But, you know, to drop Burn and play Tino, and Tino to then be part of a team that's lost 4-1 again, it's, you know, it's not going to do his confidence any good. And he made a change in the goalkeeping department as well. It's a strange one, because Dubravka was training on Friday, and, you know, from my perspective, I to hear that he's suddenly ill and didn't travel, I find it hard to believe. Was he told on Friday that he wasn't playing on Saturday, and he's decided not to travel himself? He's done it before with regards to Newcastle, you know, spat the dummy out. So from my perspective, to see Karius in goal was a big, big surprise, a big shock.
Yep.
He played okay. He did what he had to do. You know, I think his distribution's probably better than Dubravka's. But all in all, it's pretty much the same as having Dubravka in goal. There was no great difference. And, you know, he ended up picking the ball out the net four times. Alexander Isak might as well have sat in the stands. You know, he never had any balls put to him. No chance of, you know, no real chance of doing anything, you know, up front without any supply line. And Joe Willock, probably the only bright spark on the day, came on as a sub and you know, broke the hoodoo, you know, got a goal. Newcastle hadn't scored down there for over 700 minutes. So for Joe Willock to get the goal and, you know, give us a consolation was, you know, was great. But bad day at the office. Positives from the weekend, well, some of the results went our way above us, but honestly, I think the only way Newcastle will get into Europe next season is, you know, in the pre-season friendlies. I can't see it at the moment. There's a crisis of confidence in that team. We had it at December, and now it's come back again. And we've got a game on Tuesday in the FA Cup tomorrow. It's make or break. It's for our season. Newcastle go out tomorrow night. That's it. You know, you've only got league placing to look at. And yeah, it's just doom and gloom. You know, there's obviously positives. You know, there's positives in that dressing room this season, but there's a lot of negatives, and it's just the amount of goals we're conceding. Is that down to Nick Pope? Is that down to the fact that Nick Pope got injured, and you know that the back four haven't adapted to having Dubravka in goal or Karius as it was at the weekend? It shouldn't be. These are professional footballers. We're getting torn apart, and that didn't happen last year. And I think the big thing for us as well is that there was no effort at the weekend, and that at any level of football, you know, is unacceptable. That's the minimum that a fan expects, especially a fan that's travelled to London on a Saturday afternoon for an 8 o'clock kickoff on a Saturday night with no chance of getting back, you know, using a train or a plane. You've got to either get a bus back and, you know, get back at, you know, 6-7 o'clock in the morning, or stay down, which is going to cost you extra money. So, you know, they've slapped the fans in the face with that performance. You know, we could have put a lot more effort in, and we didn't. And that's what hurts supporters. You know, as the wake up this morning, looking back at that result over the weekend. But we're lucky. We've got a game tomorrow night. We've got an FA Cup game, which could get us a place in the quarterfinals. You win next weekend against Wolves, which is a tough ask. They've just gone above us in the Premier League table, and suddenly, everything's okay again. That's how fickle football is. But there needs to be a major examination into this season, I think, when it all finishes. And off the pitch, things aren't right. You know, there's lots of negativity on social media about ID checks at the stadium again. You know, one kid replied to me on X last night saying, "Yeah, but that's because it's a stop touting, Steve." It's done the polar opposite. It's basically haranguing and harassing supporters who've travelled all the way down the country and putting them on a knife edge as to whether they're going to get into the ground. What it's actually done, you know, the way that they do the away tickets now is it's created a black market online. It's just took the actual tout away from outside the ground and put them online. It's probably given an opportunity for more people to sell tickets, you know, in that way for an inflated price, and we've seen it. So that's one thing. But I've mentioned it on here a couple of times, you know, that we've got the club in dispute with supporters. We've got, the ballot that came out at the start of the season where people now were coming into the last six home games, and people haven't actually won a ballot yet to go to a game. You know, it was always going to be the case that the club haven't listened on that. The club really need to start waking up and listening to what people are saying, and the communication needs to be improved. We've had communication from the owners over the last 2 years, but that was when things were going well. This season, things have slipped a little bit, haven't gone as well, and we're seeing a bit of a two-shaped turtle movement here by some people at the club. They're withdrawn into their shell and not as communicative, and that's not a good thing. You need to come out and you need to speak. And I don't say this is, I'm not criticising the club here, let me get that right, what I'm saying, but I'm being a critical friend. I'm giving the club advice, because at the moment, you know, you know, it's not going well and you need to address it and something needs to happen. And on the pitch, that's up to Eddie Howe to get things right. But off the pitch, it's up to the owners and those people who they employ in certain positions to get things right. It's not working. Could be a lot worse. It's been a lot worse. I'm not naive enough to say that, you know, things haven't improved over the last 2 years, but we've hit a brick wall and, you know, things need to change and things need to be looked at and things need to be addressed, and that's up to the people at the club. So yeah, disappointing. We'll be looking ahead to the Blackburn game obviously tomorrow. We're lucky we've got a game quickly to recover from and get into, and just get back to the football. Harvey Barnes, what's he done wrong to find himself on the bench? I know sometimes these things are tactical, etc., but Harvey Barnes has looked our best player in the last couple of weeks, you know. Found himself on the bench, and I found that bizarre. To go into a game against Arsenal and drop somebody who'd been performing well, and I'm not really sure what kind of message that sends out to Harvey Barnes. But yeah, look, disappointing, lads. It is what it is. Some people would say, well, you're going to Arsenal, you should expect that they're running for the league, you're not. But you know, overall disappointing weekend for us. But a good weekend for me. Was nice to, despite the dreaded Lurgy, me and Nobby Solano going on the train up to Dundee this weekend, both coughing all over each other for the best part of 3 hours, and then having to put on the brave face and fill ourselves full of paracetamol as we got on the stage. But it was great. Well done to Newcastle United Scotland Supporters Association for putting on their very first event. Not easy to put events on, especially when you know you're in somewhere which you know isn't in the heart of Newcastle, and to pull in 130 fans like they did from all different parts of Scotland was absolutely fantastic. And they were raising money for three charities as well, which included the Sir Bobby Robson Foundation and the Teenage Cancer Trust, and overall just great to be able to see lots of, you know, like-minded Newcastle fans. Some were expats, some people who'd moved up to Scotland many years ago, some living in Dundee, some from Glasgow, Kilmarnock, Edinburgh. People had travelled all over for the event, and it was great. And again, very similar to what I was saying before, lots of people, those are the kind of fans who were in the ballot, and I met eight fans who were all who'd all been in the ballot this season and still not won a single ticket, and that's a cross section of supporters who are going at the ballot on a regular basis. Crazy that, like, really is, and they're not looking at this. They need to look at that system. But overall, yeah, great night. Don't know what the final total was that they made, but I'm sure we'll be back up in Dundee soon for another tour game. But well done to the lads, and it was a pleasure to spend a weekend with Nobby and chew the fat about Newcastle United.
Good stuff. And we've got excellent, a bit of suspenseful, excellent, dramatic film soundtrack here because we need to know whether I think Ted's with us. Is Ted with us? Come in, Ted.
It's I'm only taking the mic, of course.
Norman Collier. It's Norman Collier, Ted. Norman Collier, Ted. All right, I'll get rid of the suspense music then. He's with us.
Yes. Get rid of your suspenders. I'm back. Well, first of all, apologies, but I'm not going to blame my technology that I paid for. It's this horrible studio software that just does what it wants.
It's this horrible studio. It's funny.
It does what it wants. It does what it wants.
Blame Windows. It does what it wants. You know, it's strange. We don't have any problems on any of the shows. It's just you, lads. Maybe we're all just dinosaurs on this program. I don't know. Who knows?
Probably. Yeah, yeah, no.
Yeah.
Agreed.
Yeah.
Yep.
Well, speaking of dinosaurs, I think we would have. I think we actually would have benefited from a bit of old-fashioned 4-4-2 on Saturday.
Oh my God!
Honestly,
I don't even want to talk football.
No, I don't.
We've got to do news headlines though. We haven't done news headlines. No. We should get into our news headlines and get them out of the way for the three clubs.
See,
and then we can come back and give you more exciting reviews of the three Northeast teams that played football this weekend. Then we're going to get back into why nitrogen is good for your flowers this time of year.
Nice. But we'll do all that after this.
Together, across the Northeast, three brand new radio stations by the fans, for the fans, on DAB Radio, online, and smart speakers.
Right across the Northeast, the red.
Smoggies and Proud. Borough News.
Good morning, Borough fans. Happy Monday. And I say happy with a big smile and grin on my face. Michael Carrick says Middlesbrough must quickly move on from their Plymouth Argyle loss. And what a loss it was. With Borough and Boss admitting the only thing to come out of the weekend that was positive was the return of Emmanuel Latte-Lath. Borough's lack of consistency since November is now keeping in tow, with Carrick's side failing to build on the victory last weekend at Leicester City. Carrick was largely being happy with the performance of late, even when results had not gone their way, but even he conceded after that game, not many things went right. The result leaves Borough 11 points off the playoff places with 13 games remaining, and now actually closer to the relegation zone than the playoffs, ahead of Saturday's trip to Stoke City. And with that in mind, Carrick was clear on the plans for the week ahead, of one that he has demanded more from his players. He told BBC Tees, "Manu is back, and that's the only positive. He hadn't done a lot of training in the week before this one, but to have him back out there on the pitch was still good. With the games coming up in mind, it's good to have a striker. Apart from that, no, there was no positives to take." Well, I sound positive, don't I? And I know you all are too, Borough fans. On to Stoke, and we love this club. That's all we can be. That's your Borough headlines.
Magpies and Proud, Mag News.
Good morning, Newcastle fans. Newcastle United women booked their spot in the FA Women's National League Cup final thanks to a 90th minute strike from Georgia Gibson in front of the Gallagher end yesterday. United took the lead through Charlotte Potts, who headed into the far corner, but Portsmouth rallied and got back on level terms through Emma Jones when she dinked the ball over a sliding Grace Donnelly. Just as the fourth official held up 7 minutes added on, Katie Barger picked out an unmarked Gibson, who got a deft touch on the ball to guide it into the far corner and send another big St James's Park crowd wild. It was a close contest, with both sides showing off their quality and trading blows in front of a bumper 22,307 strong attendance, but it was United who came out victorious. Newcastle's run of 5 games unbeaten in League and Cup came to an abrupt end at the Emirates on Saturday night, losing 4-1. In a game that's best to forget for all involved, there was a late consolation for ex-gunner Joe Willock, which ended our goal drought at the Arsenal. And there was a decisive intervention for Yankuba Minte on Sunday, who came off the bench on the hour mark against Almere City. And with the score goalless, the Newcastle unloaned striker scored 2 goals to win Feyenoord all 3 points. That's in Newcastle headlines on Monday the 26th of February.
Mackems and Proud. Black Cats News.
Morning, Sunderland fans. Not a lot to celebrate, I'm afraid. Mike Dodds has had a say on whether Sunderland will make the playoffs after their defeat to Swansea City. Dodds' tactics didn't come off this time around, as he opted to play 5 at the back with 3 centre-backs. Sunderland struggled to get to grips with the new shape and found themselves 2-0 down at half-time. Despite Lugo 9 grabbing a goal deep into the second half, Sunderland suffered their 3rd defeat in a row. Dodds said, "There are still 12 games to go, and I'm going to be really naturally optimistic because I know we have some really good players. The result today isn't going to help us push for the top 6, but we still have 12 games to go. I'm still confident in the way we work. I'm still confident in terms of the group we've got." Former Newcastle United captain Scott Parker is now the bookmaker's favourite to replace Michael Beale at Sunderland. Talk about Sunderland's next appointment are cool, but bookies are now back in a shock front runner in the race. Ex-Toon skipper Parker has been out of work since losing his job at Club Bruges last season. His last job in English football came at Bournemouth, where he was sacked just 4 games into the 2022-23 campaign, after leading them to promotion, of course. Parker also won the Championship playoff final as Fulham manager back in 2020. But his Newcastle allegiances may prove an obstacle for Sunderland supporters. The 43-year-old spent 2 years on Tyneside during the mid-2000s, taking over the armband in 2006 following Alan Shearer's retirement. And finally, big congratulations to former Sunderland youth team player James McConnell, who has won the Carabao Cup with Liverpool against Chelsea. McConnell joined Liverpool from Sunderland at under-15 level, one of a number of impressive and high-profile youngsters to depart the stadium alight under the ownership of Madrox during the club's relegation to League One. There are your headlines this morning.
Magpies and Proud. Mag News.
Well, I'm not going to read the headlines out again.
That was fantastic, that one. Oh, excellent.
Monday. Monday
it's
morning
gone good swimmingly.
We're having fun.
Nobody knew who's doing the show. The mics don't work. Dave was late. He spat porridge on the equipment. He dinged his ball during Rise headlines. Honestly.
I'm telling you. That's what happens when you get three defeats for a Sunderland Newcastle.
Yeah, it all goes to shock, doesn't it? Righto, let's kick it off. We're going to get Middlesbrough out of the way. Yeah, I'm going to get it out of the way because I don't want to talk about it anymore. We've heard about Steve, obviously, Newcastle losing 4-1 to Arsenal. Middlesbrough lost Plymouth Argyle 2-0 at home as our home form continues to be absolutely abysmal. I am going to try and stay as lighthearted as I can here on the radio, but that was one of the worst games of football I've ever sat down and watched. Middlesbrough registered 0 shots on target for the whole 90 minutes. That's right, 0 shots on target. So imagine sitting there at 2 a.m. doing a watch-along, watching your team have 0 shots on targets. Yes, that's as much fun as I had. Then we saw the substitutions of Finnis Zaz and Riley McGree, arguably our two most creative midfielders, off in the 55th minute, which has been unlike Carrick, who has been making subs in the 80th minute. Michael Carrick after the game said, it's all on him and he got his set up today's team wrong. He said, looking back, he said, the only positive I had was Manu coming back. Well, you're not wrong there. It was a shocking afternoon for Middlesbrough. We just weren't out of it right from the get-go. We had optimism going in. We were at the 6 medals before the game, live here on the red. And the overwhelming response was that we were going to get a 2-1 victory. After beating Leicester, you'd think that maybe that sort of just turns the tide of the season. Maybe the positive in the lads to take that back home to a packed Riverside on a sunny afternoon would be enough. Well, it wasn't. The boys started off sluggishly. Michael Carrick ringing in 3 changes, going away from that back 3, or back 5, you should say, that worked so well against Leicester, back to a normal 4-2-3-1. Sammy Silvera leading the line as well, and unfortunately, Middlesbrough just could not get out of the box. We had no shots on target. We had no real attacking threat. We were outside the box. I think the ball went into the box in the first half once and maybe in the second half twice, and that was about it. All the shots that Middlesbrough had to create were from outside the box, i.e. registering no shots on target. It was a disastrous afternoon and pretty much labels us a mid-table finish now. I just don't see us getting anywhere near those playoffs. And in fact, like I said in the headlines, Middlesbrough are now closer to the relegation zone than they are the playoffs. And we just need to focus on now just trying to get a couple more results just to secure that mid-table finish and just crawl to the end of the line that is this season so that we can get into a summer and rebuild, which we need to do. We need a striker. It's as simple as that. We need a striker. We cannot keep playing without a striker. We saw the return of Latte Lath, and hopefully he'll be obviously able to start. But I tell you what, even he had a lot of work to do in that second half, and he looked a bit off, obviously coming back after a severe injury layoff, not playing since that Chelsea hamstring. And of course, he's the only fit striker now available to the Borough. It's going to be a long few games. Middlesbrough seem to be able to do well against the top teams and struggle against the bottom teams. It's always been our sort of classic Borough mentality, but unfortunately Middlesbrough now travel to Stoke City, and guess what? They're in a relegation battle, and the social media sort of outlook to that is, well, if you need 3 points and you're in a relegation battle, look no further than the Borough to help you out, because Borough now travel to Stoke. Stoke beat us in the reverse fixture after a bad run of fixtures. Again, they only now travel down to Stoke on a Saturday afternoon and trying to find 3 points away from home. Arguably, the only optimism we have is that our away form is better than our home form. Go figure that. It's going to be a tough afternoon at Stoke. We're going to have to try and see if Michael Carrick rings in the changes. You would argue that Senny Dieng, Matt Clark, Latte Lath, those types of players need to start this weekend. We need to dig in for the most ugliest draw against Stoke, or even a 3 points against Stoke this weekend. Arguably, one of the worst performances I've ever seen, Dave. I can't remember looking back and thinking of a much worse performance. The only positive I took out of the weekend was an amazing food bank that we saw set up by the fans prior to the match.
Yeah, that was the highlight of the weekend. So it tells you all about what happened on the pitch. Horrible. I mean, it's the first time I've seen the Riverside so empty towards the end of a game. So many people just wandering away. Timing is not perfect, is it? I mean, that's very damaging. And the reason why it's very damaging is it comes straight on the back of this dispute between club and fans about season cards.
Exactly.
And there's so many people were sitting around me at the Riverside on Saturday saying, well, that's it. That's made my mind up. I'm not renewing next season now. I know some of that will be in the moment. And when it comes to getting the disappointment of the display at the Riverside out of the system, a few of them will reconsider, but I bet a few don't, because there's a few guys sit around me I actually know quite well, know personally, and you know they would if they're telling me they're not renewing, then they won't renew because I know them, I know the character, I know what type of guys they are. So timing's absolutely everything, and I think we've shot ourselves in the foot by putting in the worst display of the season. Straight off the back of all the issues that were building up to that game. I suppose you could ask the question, has this row between club and fans disrupted things?
I was going to ask you that.
I really don't see how that can impact Michael Carrick and the players. If it was going to disrupt anything, it would be the running, the operations of the club, the communications of the club. I really don't see that would impact the players. And the reason why I say that is I've seen glimpses of that performance in other games this season. You know, even before the season ticket renewal details were issued. Now, you only see them for a half and then the Borough come out and correct it. Or you see them for parts of a game and then they sort themselves out. This was just 90 minutes of unexciting, unentertaining. I hate to use the term football because it really didn't resemble a football match. And there were boos at the Riverside as early as the first goal going in. And that was scored on 7 minutes. Then there were more boos when the second goal went in, which was just short of the half hour. And they just continued. You know, at half time when the whistle went, there were a lot of boos. So there's a lot of dissatisfaction in amongst the stands at the Riverside. And then when you see the Riverside empty as it was when the full-time whistle went, I've never seen that in a long, long time. It just shows you what dissatisfaction there is circulating around the fans.
Yeah, no, it was shocking. Unfortunately, as well,
Michael Carrick came out and said he thought the lads played well. I mean, where does he get that from? I mean, I obviously didn't see the game. But, you know, he basically said, the boys tried and gave their best today. The longer it went, the harder it became, and that's on me today. I'll take that one. So he accepted responsibility, but, you know, he clearly saw something that he was pleased with. But listening to you two guys, there was nothing to be happy about.
There was nothing to be happy about.
No, not one player can put their hand up and say they played well on that game. I'm sorry, there isn't one. All the boys were off it.
Protecting these players, then.
And it was. I think it was. It was trying to take the onus. It was 100% him trying to take the onus off the boys and put it on his back. He was trying to say, "Look, this is my fault. I got the team selection wrong. I got the tactics wrong. I got and put it on my shoulders. Don't put it on the boys." And again, that's what you have to do as a gaffer sometimes. Is you need to take, you know, because you can tell it's been an arguably frustrating week for Borough. We came off the back of last week of a team meeting where the supporter group sat down with Steve Gibson, and arguably Steve Gibson was irate in that meeting, saying, "Look, I've had to raise the prices because I need to run this club how I need to run the club so that it's profitable." And then you guys are coming out and saying that you're going to protest against me after everything I've done, sort of thing. So it's a really, really icy sort of atmosphere at the moment between club and fans. You saw that the protest was cancelled because they were happy with the under-18s and that. But then the fans ended up leaving anyway because of the performance. So whether it was the protest or not, most fans were leaving by halftime anyway. I mean, the Riverside I was looking at it on the screen, and the more empty seats was damning. You could see the crowd. I mean, the loudest thing was was it 1,800? I think it was Plymouth fans in the tight corner of the Riverside. They were the absolute loudest fans, and they've been up since 4 a.m. to come up to the Borough. So it was disgusting. It was shocking. It's one that it's one of the worst performances I've seen from a Middlesbrough outfit in a very long time. And we're very, very, very far off it at the moment.
I'll go as far as saying that is the worst Borough performance I've seen in several years. It wasn't just this season. There seem to be so many disconnects. There seem to be so much... disconnect is the best word between players on the field. You couldn't really understand the tactics we were trying to employ. There was no urgency. You know, Plymouth were better on the ball. They were faster in possession. They looked more dangerous when they attacked. They looked more confident on the field. And the Riverside has become a bit of a playground for away teams this season. You know, our away record is better than our home record, and I just don't understand it. I don't know how we've turned our home ground into that sort of welcoming place where away teams must come, apart from Leicester City, away teams must come and they must go, hey, we've got a chance of winning today. The bookies had had Plymouth on Saturday 5-1 to win in a two-horse race. That's what the bookies saw. And we just see it repeated over and over again. We see teams, poor teams, coming to the Riverside and turning us over this season. I just don't get it. I really don't. We've got a far better squad, even with the injuries, than half of these teams that come to the Riverside. And yet we just fail to perform over and over again.
Yeah, I'm not sure what it is. There's got to be, like Steve said as well, when he was saying and asking that Newcastle have a bit of a look back at the end of the season of what maybe went wrong. Well, I'll tell you what, Middlesbrough got to do it. And I'll tell you, and for me, the first part is the recruitment in January. January really did put a burner on our season. We lost Rogers, we lost Matt Crooks, obviously, but we were so desperate for a striker and Middlesbrough weren't willing to throw money down the drain. I get that, but it has left us seriously, seriously short. And I can argue that watching a game of football for 90 minutes with zero shots on target is the worst imaginable thing you can put a fan through. It was horrid. And if you can't throw money down a drain to get a shot on target, then it sums it up. We've got Latte last back now. Again, that's the only positive. He's our only fit striker. Maybe he can get a few more shots on target, maybe starting against Stoke next weekend. The best thing is that Stoke are currently in the relegation zone for the first time this season. They fell after a loss on the weekend into 22nd spot. And Middlesbrough will travel to Stoke now next weekend. But we all know what we like when we play against Rotherham and teams down below. And we saw that against Plymouth as well, who have won two away games this whole season, by the way. And that was their third win on the weekend. Anyway, that's enough about Borough. We've spoken about Newcastle, got that out of the way. We got Borough out of the way. Let's get Sunderland out of the way. And then we're going to talk about gardening, cars, and everything that makes us happy. Maybe fairy floss or something like that. Sunderland, obviously, at home. Yeah, you know, what do you call it? You call it cotton candy, don't you? You call it cotton candy,
no,
don't
that's
you?
The Americans. We call it candy floss.
Candy floss.
You guys, what are you guys going to be different?
Laughing at?
All right.
What was that snigger
fairy floss?
We're not different. We invented it, mate.
We just took it over with you.
Candy floss? Candy floss doesn't make sense.
Well, now they're just fairy floss.
At least it's mine. It does. At least little fairies came and made like the sugar.
What we need to do is get your voice
to
go higher so bats can hear it. There's dogs in my street going nuts.
All right. Now I'm going to talk about Sunderland even more because I was going to be nice to him, but now stuff him. Sunderland absolutely choked on the weekend. It was funny to see. They had Swansea. We all predicted a 3-1 victory to Sunderland. Well, I know at least I did. Sunderland were desperate for a win, obviously, since the sacking of Beale. And Mike Dawes coming in to try and get a win against Swansea City, who, again, were in not the best form. They are sitting in 17th, and they travel to Sunderland. Probably, again, the bookies' favourite to get an absolute walloping, and Sunderland were unable to do it. The time I looked over at halftime, it was 2-0 to Swansea, and then in the second half, Sunderland were able to bring one back through Luke 09. Ted, what happened to the Dodds?
Well, a well-worn expression of this show now from me. There's a lot to unpack here. So it was he hinted already on Friday there was going to be a sort of a surprise to the lineup. There was. Callum Stiles made his debut, albeit as left wing back. And yeah, we shifted to three centre backs, the wing backs, and then the rest of the side was kind of, it was odd. It was a weird lineup playing Abdullah Bar out on the left, where you would expect to see him either centrally or playing on the right. None of what I predicted came to fruition. Rusin was left to kind of plough his own channel again. That kid never stops working hard, and he was one of the few to come off with any real credit, to be honest. We missed that creativity from Clark, obviously. You know, a player like Jack Clark, who's been rumoured in that £20 to £25 million bracket, of course you are going to miss someone like that in your team. However, you know, you look around the squad and you think, OK, well, there's still enough about this squad to put pay to that. It just got off to the worst possible start. The team looked like strangers, and I don't... I feel like it was the shape. I feel like it was this whole three centre-backs. It's something that this season I don't recall us playing. I can't recall us doing it at any time last season either. I know Mogga's not really a big fan of that anyway. There were players who previously have impressed, but over the last couple of games have really gone backwards. And Hjelde is one of them. That debut we had against Borough, we all said, you know, he looked solid. He looked like he'd had a really good game, made some key interceptions. For the second goal, Hjelde was kind of, he was out of position as the left centre back. He was standing around kind of, you know, when you kind of, you know, when you shine a laser pen for a cat and it kind of, it's looking all over the place for it and it's trying to anticipate where it's going to go next, but it's actually stood still. That's exactly what Hjelde was like in the second goal. So he really had a bad one. Callum Stiles, I feel heartily sorry for. He was played out at left wing back. Now, he has played there a little bit in the past, but by trade, for his international team, for Hungary, he plays as a central midfielder. And he's even said in the interview after, well, my natural position and my favourite position is actually in a central role. And you're kind of thinking, so was that conversation had at all? You know, prior to the game, go, well, all right, Gaffer, I'll do what you need us to do, but my preferred position is this. That would have been, you know, maybe a decent conversation to have. So 2-0 down, the shape absolutely did not work. Dodds did change it, like, very, very quickly. But by then, the damage is done. Without any word of a lie, it could have been about 5 or 6-0 at half-time to Swansea. They really were all over us. Credit to them, mind, because any time we did get the ball, they put men behind the ball. They made it really difficult to break them down. I genuinely think those players are lying to Luke Williams, their manager, because their position in the league was no indication of how well they played. They did play very, very well. It was just so frustrating to watch. You know, we had the same problems. We had Job, who's so easy to push off the ball. Ekwa kind of grew into the game a little bit, but he had a stinker of a first half. Dan Neil was even quiet as well. I love Dan Neil. He's been in good form recently. And obviously, you know, missing Dan Ballard through suspension as well. You look at somebody like that, yeah, you start and miss them. The one thing that, like, sort of irks me a little bit with the defensive situation is we had someone who was coming through really nicely in Nectar Triantis, and they've sent him out on loan to Hibs. He's been dropped by Hibs, and you've got Hjelder in there who kind of is looking more and more like, well, Leeds must be absolutely delighted that they've managed to get rid of him. It's just weird. I just find some of the decision-making process at the club very, very strange. What I will say is Swansea have hung their hat on a manager who I think is going places, and maybe Sunderland, Sunderland fans in particular, me included, I'm just as guilty of this. Maybe we need to stop being as precious and actually have a look at some of these managers who are coming through the ranks. Luke Williams took Notts County back into the league. Obviously, he was featured in the whole Wrexham documentary as well as like their nemesis, I guess. But he's got them really, really well organised. I was really impressed by them. Haven't spent an awful lot of money. I thought a good advert for young English managers out there, and somebody we could potentially, you know, that kind of model is something we really need to start and take a look at. The Scott Parker thing obviously is quite worrying, because he'll not be given a chance by anybody with the Newcastle links, of course. But back to the game, second half, a lot better, admittedly, but really it couldn't get any worse. We were chasing the game. Luke O'Neill took his goal really, really well, over the moon for the lad. But even a 2-1 down, I'm kind of thinking there's just not enough about them. It was strange tactics. It was strange selection from Dodds. He's taken it. I mean, he's in the position there. He said he was going to make bold decisions, and that's what he's going to do for the rest of the season. But, you know, it just kind of, it wasn't a Sunderland performance. We expected to see us, right, okay, great. Bale's gone. We can get back to the attacking football, you know, with pace, with a bit of fight about them, all that kind of thing. and it just looked wrong. It was just weird. It was the most un-Sunderland performance of the season so far. And the experiment with the shape, I love Dodsey and I know he's well respected in the club, but that experiment was, it wasn't the time or the place to do that. We didn't need to do that. We had very, very simple answers to the problem in terms of what was on the bench. You play Roosen on the wing, you stick Barr on the right wing, you give Hamir a chance up front. And that would have worked. That would have absolutely worked. And it would have been a shape that is natural to the players and not take them out of their comfort zone when they've already suffered two defeats in a row. That's not the time to start messing about and start experimenting. They need to play themselves back into form. But, I mean, the good news is we've got an ideal opportunity to do it now because we've only got Norwich, Leicester and Southampton the next three games.
Easy run.
It's disastrous. Disastrous. The thing is now, and I feel the frustration from the Borough a lot as well. Obviously, you know, listening to you guys, it's kind of almost like a mirror image of our game, I suppose. But do you just feel now that, like, we're not looking at, well, which one's going to finish higher? It's more of a case of which one's going to finish lowest.
I don't even know what I'm looking at anymore from a Borough point of view. I'm looking at to see how much we can save till the end of the season in terms of staying out of the relegation battle. We are just so up and down and consistency that, yeah, you're absolutely right. It's probably, I mean, we're, there's no way we'd be focusing on playoffs anymore. And I'm starting to buy into that whole social media aspect that the Borough have sort of thrown this season away, hoping for a big build-up next season, especially with the injuries to Hayden Hackney and Johnny Howson and keeping them on ice as well. There are the rumours that Hayden Hackney's been put on ice because there were the heavy sort of, you know, sales points of view coming this summer, and maybe they put him on ice just to hide him away till next season to have a right push.
I genuinely think that.
And exactly like, exactly right. And there are some, you know, sort of tactics and game managements there that you can probably read into, but, you know, you wait and see. But, yeah, I think you're right. I think it's a battle of who finishes lower at the moment. You know, Middlesbrough have gotten it wrong, albeit keeping the same manager, and Sunderland seem to have gotten it wrong more off the pitch than they have on the pitch. I feel like you've still got a strong team. I thought Roosen and everyone like that on their day, but, you know, when they've got managers coming in left, right and centre, it's probably hard to get any consistency when there's no consistency off the pitch.
What do you think the club should do in this case? Now, a question to all you lads as well. Mm. What do you think Sunderland's ownership should do now? Do they wait until the summer and appoint somebody? Or
no.
Does this need actually, right, make a decision on your head coach, get them in to see what they've got to work with, and then obviously, you know, work on it over the summer? Is it something that needs to be done now? And is Scott Parker actually the man to do that?
Nah.
We'll stop you, Steve.
Nah.
Scott Parker's not the man, mate. No, definitely not. I don't think that's a great appointment at all. Honestly, I would stick with Dodds until the end of the season. Reason being that I think changing managers, you know, the kind of rate you're talking about never does well in the dressing room. You know, to go from, you know, Mogger to Beale to, you know, well, Mogger to Dodds to Beale to Dodds to another. I don't think that's a recipe for success at all at any club. So, you know, it's not going to lead to relegation this season. But I mean, Newcastle did that, didn't they? They had they had Allardyce, they had Keegan, they had Kinnear. crazy trying to go through some kind of process in a dressing room.
12 points off the bottom three, Steve.
I still think you'd be fine.
It's not time for a knee jerk, is it though? That would be so destabilising. You know, what if you
Dodds will give you, Dodds will give you that kind of stabilisation. That's what I was looking for, Dave. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, if I was sitting there in the chief exec's chair, I'd be saying to KLD, what you need to do now is you need to be building for next season. You know, if we make a knee jerk reaction and pull some manager in now, who we've not really done our full homework on, because we did that on Beale and it turned out to be a disaster, so we've taken our eye off the ball. You know, you could actually create a worse situation than you're in now. You know, the instability in the dressing room, yet somebody else with different ideas and a different voice leading the players. The instability from a club perspective, because how many managers is this you'll have had this season? You know, my advice would be, Dodds is good enough with the squad we've got to take that risk of staying in the table. We're not going to get sucked into a relegation battle. We're not. And what you should be doing is spending all your time now lining up who your first choice is going to be and doing everything you can to go and get them. So what you've got to do is you've got to look at who's out of work, but you've also got to look at who's in work, whose contracts are coming to an end in the summer. So who's available? And on top
spend
of that,
money, Sunderland.
And on top of that, you've then got to look at who's still in contract through the summer, who we might be willing to get if they are absolutely nailed on, 100% the best candidate for the job. And we've got to spend some. We've got to spend some money on compensation. So you've got between now and this season ending to get your homework done, to start talking to prospective coaches for next season, so you can get all that lined up as quickly as possible, but just let Dodds run it to the end of the season. That's all you've got to do. That'll bring in a bit of stability, a bit of familiarity. Hopefully there'll be enough results there for Sunderland to stay in the league, which there will be. You know, we're talking about Sunderland. They're sitting above the Borough, for God's sake. Borough's 9 points adrift of the relegation zone. That's just three results. Sunderland are ahead of that. So I don't think you've got any concerns at the Stadium of Light in terms of relegation. I think you can throw that out the window. You can forget that now, because you're going to pick up enough points and there's enough bad teams below you that will make sure, and if you didn't, they won't either. So forget relegation. I think you should use this time now to focus on what you need for next season and get the homework done. And for God's sake, do it properly this time.
Yeah, it's got to be. It's got to be done properly this time. I'll tell you who I would really like to see in the Sunderland top six. Now, having to think about this over the weekend, thinking where do they go with this? Somebody who is proven in that level, who can deal with the day to day rigors of the championship, all that kind of thing. Somebody who's respected. I would love to see us go for Mark Robbins. Really would.
I don't think you can get him. I don't think you can get him. I honestly, because I think we're exactly the same. But I don't think you can get him. I don't think he leaves Coventry. He's been there, and they are doing such a good job, and they've been backing him year in, year out.
Only 1 point above.
I don't think he's available. Yeah, but I don't think you can get him. I honestly think if Mark Robbins leaves, it's for a Premier League or something like that, but I honestly don't see him leaving to go anywhere. The only chance I think Sunderland have this season is someone that's out of work, that's got a senior sort of head around them. I would have said a Neil Warnock, get you a home. You would have been perfect to get you home for the run at the end of the season. And even Mogger coming back, do you know what I mean? If he was, you know, if he was out of work, because, you know, someone like that, that's just got, I've seen that rumour as well. There's no way Sunderland, and I know Sunderland, there are a few representatives probably that listen to the show. Don't do that, all right? Please learn from your mistakes. Michael Beale was the worst appointment you've done, and you put the fans straight off the bat offside. If you now go back and get Snakehead or Voldemort and put him back in charge, you might as well rip up season tickets. You might as well go and decorate the bar with Slytherin stuff from Harry Potter. That's how much you would be treating the fans if you put Alex Neil back in charge. Don't do that. Okay, listen from us, all right? We might not have it all together. We might not know who's running the show. We might not have jingles all organised. We might have to, you know, or sort things out. But we know this.
Put your finger at me. Go on, Neil, shoot me.
Alex Neil is the wrong appointment, okay? Do not do it. All right, please, Sunderland, learn from your mistakes. Do not go and upset this fan base anymore, because we're for the fans, by the fans, and the fans do not want Alex Neil, okay? And now, it doesn't take a smart person to realise that. Now, go and get yourself a senior head, or give Dozzy till the end of the season to get it right, and then try and look at it at the end. But I tell you what, please, please, Sunderland, for the sake of our North East Football Brekkie show, do not stuff this up.
Ted, I've got a question for you.
Yes, mate.
What would the fans' reaction be to pulling in somebody like Peter Reid at the moment, just to add a little bit of maturity, almost a calming head, because he's been there and done it, just to oversee things with Dodsey at the moment?
I'm
not saying he's coming in as manager.
This is a compliment, Steve.
I'm saying he would come in as a bit of a senior head, just to help.
Yeah, yeah. There are two kinds of fans in this world. There are the people who are of a certain age who have been through an awful lot supporting this great club of ours. Then you have the social media crew, and the social media crew, by and large, Generation Z, never lived through the Peter Reid days and all that sort of thing. I think the people of an older persuasion would be absolutely delighted to have Peter Reid walk through those doors again, because he oversaw the most successful part. I know that he didn't win anything, all right, yeah. But in terms of league position, two seventh place finishers in the Premier League, I mean, he'd be given the freedom of the city if he achieved something like that in modern day. But, you know, he oversaw all of that. He's well loved by the club, by the fans as well. Somebody like that walking in to sort of give a bit of seniority, like you say, I think that is very much what's needed. And I still think, even I don't know what age Reedy's at these days, like, but I still think, you know, given a performance like what the players turned in the first half on Saturday, Reedy would absolutely lay into that. And I think there'd be a few home truths, and I think some players in that squad need to be told some home truths. I would be, you know, all in favour of that, 100%. Yeah.
He's 67,
it makes
by
me
the way.
Think, Dave. You know who makes me think?
Yeah.
Get Bernie Slaven in to the borough at the moment. Bernie Slaven with his no BS. I'm dead serious, mate. The way he talks on a Monday night is absolutely what borough need right now. Bernie Slaven, go into our club and tell them the home truths that they need to hear at the moment. That's what I'm begging you to do. It's probably the no BS route, you know, we'll probably put a few offside, but I tell you what, sometimes it's what we need, because I don't know what's going on, but he would go in and like a Peter Reid.
Well, I'm just thinking back to when Robbo was struggling. You know, at the Borough, Brian Robson, he had a great run. He went through a real and it was a real bad sticky patch, and it was the start of the end for Robbo. But they brought Terry Venables in just as that senior person who Robbo could lean on. He could ask for advice. Eltel could spot things that Robbo was just too into the weeds to spot. And that's what I'm suggesting. Would it work? Yeah. Would it work for Dodsey if somebody like a Peter Reid came in, who's got the experience, who's done it all before, whether you love him or hate him, with a modern day era on social media? I mean, he wouldn't be up front and centre. He would just be working in there with them. Dodsey would still be the head coach, manager, whatever you want to call it. But he's got some experience to draw on. That's all I was asking.
Fabulous man manager as well.
Yeah.
Absolutely fabulous.
He'd sort a few egos out as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I'd go and make the suggestion, mate. Go, I know you've got Reedy's number. Go and tell him how he's hat in the ring.
I think it's KLD who listens to the show, mate. So if you're listening, Kirill, go get Reedy. And hire me as your chief exec. I'll sort your club out. Don't you worry. I'm bringing Ted Stephen Ryan as head of entertainment. Good, all right.
And tell you what, you wait till the jingles you get from us.
Or not, as the case may be this morning.
We'll bring Chrome to the table.
love it.
Well, it's 8 a.m. here on the North East Brekkie Show, so it is time for some news. We'll be back right after this. We'll do some more club headlines, and we'll get into some more friendlier, happier topics after we've covered the three North East teams this morning. And we all know that your drive into work needs to be more happier to get you to work on a Monday morning. So we promise the topics we discuss the next hour will be fun, lighthearted, and all about gardening.
And just because the thespian amongst us delivers it so well, go on, Steve, I like it.
News.
The red, the tune, the cat, weather.
Oh, it's going to be showery during the morning. It's not good news, is it, when you think about it? But we will see sunny spells a little bit later on. Chilly start as well. Temperatures maximum just 7 degrees tonight. Skies are going to clear as the day progresses. That means there's a bit of bad news. It means the temperature's going to drop tonight. We are talking minus 3 degrees across the northeast. Oh dear me.
From Yarm to Yibby, Harrington to Horsley Hill, Swalwell to Silverlink, the North East Footy Breakfast with Roy, Steve and Ted.
Right across the North East, the red, the tune and the cat.
And the boys will be right back after a bit of Deegan Blue. I like this one. Dignity.
There's a man I meet, walks up our street. He's a worker for the council, has been 20 years, and he takes no lip off nobody and litter up and never think of
Deacon Blue and Dignity. I think we're showing a lot of it on this show, boys. You know, three defeats. We're holding our heads up high. Dignified comment. Let's talk gardening. Oh, we got to say congratulations. Oh, look, let's have a positive note. We've got to say congratulations to Darlow. Yes. Steve Watson, Darlow. Another victory. So now, what is it? Just 5 points away from safety. So they are clawing it back. So fingers crossed for Darlow. And?
Happy birthday to Bam. The Borough fan.
Oh, happy birthday, man.
How do you know?
Happy birthday.
On his social media. He's a friend.
Oh. Is it a friend?
A friend. Happy birthday,
Bam. Happy birthday,
Bam. I don't want to talk about social media.
Shall we do some headlines?
I'm going to talk about headlines, yeah.
Yeah, I thought so. Here we go. Yeah.
Magpies and Proud. Mags News.
Newcastle United women have booked their spot in the FA Women's National League Cup final thanks to a 90th minute strike from Georgia Gibson in front of the Gallagher end. United took the lead through Charlotte Potts, who headed into the far corner, but Portsmouth rallied and got back on level terms through Emma Jones when she dinked the ball over a sliding Grace Donnelly. Just as the fourth official held up 7 minutes added on the board, Katie Barker picked out an unmarked Gibson, who got a deft touch on the ball to guide it into the far corner and send another big St James's Park crowd wild. It was a close contest with both sides showing off their quality and trading blows in front of a bumper 22,307 strong attendance, but it was United who came out victorious. Newcastle's run of 5 games unbeaten in League and Cup came to an abrupt end at the Emirates on Saturday night, losing 4-1. In a game that's best to forget for all involved, there was a late consolation for ex-gunner Joe Willock, which ended our goal drought at the Arsenal. And there was a decisive intervention for Yakuba Minte on Sunday, who came off the bench on the hour mark against Almeria City, and with the score goalless, the Newcastle online striker scored 2 goals to win Feyenoord all 3 points. And starting a social media fury about bringing him back next season. Could he make it in the Premiership? We will have to wait and see. That is your headlines on Monday the 26th of February.
Mackems and Proud. Black Cats News.
Good morning, Sunderland fans. Mike Dodds has had his say on whether Sunderland will make the playoffs after their defeat to Swansea City. Dodds' tactics didn't come off this time around as he opted to play with 3 centre-backs. Sunderland struggled to get the grips with the new shape and found themselves 2-0 down at half-time. Despite Luke O'Neill grabbing a goal deep into the second half, Sunderland sunk to their 3rd defeat in a row. Dodds had this to say. There are still 12 games to go and I'm going to be really naturally optimistic because I know we have some really good players. The result today isn't going to help the push for the top 6, but we still have 12 games to go. I'm still confident in the way we work, I'm still confident in terms of the group we've got. Former Newcastle United captain Scott Parker is now the bookies' favourite to replace Michael Beale at Sunderland. Talk about Sunderland's next appointment had cooled, but bookies are now back in the shop frontrunner in the race. Ex-Toon skipper Parker has been out of work since losing his job at Club Bruges last season. His last job in English football, of course, came at Bournemouth, where he was sacked just 4 games into the 2022-23 campaign after leading them to promotion. Parker also won the Championship playoff final as Fulham manager back in 2020. But his Newcastle allegiances may prove an obstacle for Sunderland supporters. The 43-year-old spent 2 years on Tyneside in the mid-noughties, taking over the armband in 2006 following Alan Shearer's retirement. And finally, big congratulations to former Sunderland youth team player James McConnell, who has won the Carabao Cup with Liverpool against Chelsea. McConnell joined Liverpool from Sunderland at under-15 level, one of a number of impressive and high-profile youngsters to depart the stadium alight under the ownership of Madrox following the club's relegation to League One. They are your Sunderland headlines.
Smoggies and Proud. Borough News.
Good morning, Borough fans. Happy Monday. Michael Carrick says Middlesbrough must move on quickly and true right from their Plymouth Argyle loss, with the Borough boss admitting the only positive to come from this weekend was the return from injury for Emmanuel Latte-Lath. In keeping with Borough's lack of consistency since November, the Carrick side failed to build on the victory over Leicester City last weekend as we lost again on home turf. While Carrick has largely been happy with performances of late, even when results have not gone their way, even he conceded after that game that not many things went right. The result left Borough 11 points off the playoff places with 13 games remaining, and we now actually sit a little bit closer to the relegation zone than the playoffs ahead of Saturday's trip to Stoke City. With that in mind, Carrick was clear on the plans for the week ahead of that one. He demanded more from his players. He told BBC Tees that Manu was back and that's a positive, but I need more from the lads in training this week. We have to have him back out there on the pitch. This is Manu, and it was still good for this weekend coming. But with the games coming up in mind and having only one striker, we're still going to be very short. I need more from this playing group coming into a big, big run home if we're to get anything from the rest of this season. That is your Barrow headlines. True, right, Michael? That was one to forget about.
Yeah, let's forget about football and talk gardening, boys. There you go.
Yep, that was a shocking
outside of gardening, what else could we discuss for the next 45 minutes?
Well, we got a lot to discuss about because I can go to my favourite, Chris Wilder at Sheffield United. What's going on, Wilder boy? Hello, sandwich man. As Sheffield United lost to Wolves on the weekend, I actually found this hilarious because Chris Wilder was at the forefront of this one. He said that seeing a scuffle between two players was maybe this kickstart that they needed to their season.
Really?
Very, very funny. Chris Wilder saw his two players in Jack Robertson and Vinicius Souza shoving each other as Blaze suffered another defeat at the Molineux against Wolves. And Wilder had this to say after the match. He said, "I want them to be respectful, but you should imagine my response to stuff like that." Imagine they were eating a sandwich. "My response is that it's a passionate game. They're at each other. And so as long as it doesn't overstep the mark," it was very close to doing that though. "I don't want to see it every week, but if it takes something like that to get people going, and I thought we were going to get going anyway, there's two boys desperate to win. So let's not make too much of it." Well, Chris, we're going to make too much of it here on the North East Brekkie Show because we need to focus on something else other than our teams, and it is your turn. I absolutely think it's hilarious that he thinks that two players from their own team scuffling is the kickstart you need for your season when you're bottom of the Premier League, Teddy boy, because I couldn't think of anything worse, to be honest with you, if I was a fan looking in.
I think that's just... I get almost where he's coming from on it. Well, you want to see some passion, you want to see some fight. Not fighting each other, literally, though. I mean, in terms of, like, sort of a Kieran Dyer versus Lee Bowyer, it had nothing on that, to be honest. It was a little bit of pushy-shovey. It wasn't at the same level, it wasn't at the same intensity. That's why it's not going down as one of the greatest football and boxing matches of all time in my book. but, yeah, there was, you know... I suppose you want to see that to an extent, but that for me just it screamed of just a team that's capitulated and are going to disappear out the Premier League with a whimper, to be honest. Whether Wilder stays there, he's clearly not up to the job. He really isn't. And obviously, you know, I listen to you guys. I'm not just saying it because obviously, you know, I'm going to side with you guys or anything like that. He clearly looks out of his depth. He doesn't talk like a Premier League manager. He doesn't behave like a Premier League manager. I just don't think the guy's got any class at all. And to be honest, Sheffield United going to be a miss from the Premier League? Absolutely not. And that sort of amateur antics on the pitch just kind of confirms why they are where they are, in my opinion.
Yeah, it's never good, Stevie boy, to see two players from their own team. Obviously something you're familiar with back in the heyday.
Yeah.
But, yeah, not something that you'd want to see from Sheffield United when you're bottom of the table. You've got some of the biggest losses you've ever seen in Sheffield United history in the Premier League. Looking like they're going to bow out with a couple of mates going at each other on a dismal Sunday afternoon performance again.
Yeah, I mean, to see two players go head-to-head, you know, your own players, is ridiculous. I mean, it was a shoving match. It was handbags. It was nothing else. Wilder obviously said there was no issues. He said it happens at every club up and down the country three or four times a year. He says you can't condone it. It's, you know, it has to stay at a level because we've got responsibility to young kids out there. But he says it happens every day behind closed doors at football clubs up and down the country, you know, whether you're Man City or bottom of the league in Division 2. So, you know, it's not what you want to see. Sheffield United are in a right mess. Have been since Newcastle went down there and beat them 8-0, but they've had some horrendous reverses and they're just completely out of their depth. And, yeah, it's frustrating for them. You know, the players, you know, must really, you know, not look forward to, you know, turning up on a Saturday or Sunday and stepping out into the onto the pitch, because, you know, they're just second best to everything, you know. They can't score goals, they're conceding them like they're going out of fashion. And I bet they just can't wait for this season to end. But you know, it's not quite a similarity between Boya and Dyer in 2005. I mean, that was probably, it's an iconic, you know, fallout. I went through a list whilst the news was on of others, and I mean, there's been some over the years. You forget about some of them, but Hugo Lloris and Son against.
Oh,
Everton,
yeah, true.
That was one which was, you know, Lloris was foaming about him not tracking back, and you know, he ran over and shoved him in the back when the teams left the pitch, which you know, was captured by all the cameras. One which I'd completely forgotten about, but I do remember, was Grobbelaar and McManaman in 93, which was again, it comes down to, you know, something not going right in a particular game. But, you know, Grobbelaar was furious with McManaman because he failed to clear a ball properly, and it allowed Everton to score in the Merseyside derby. Huge game, of course. McManaman then argued back with him, and it was a backwards and forwards between the two, and Grobbelaar pushed his young teammate like in the face. So, you know, again, it's one. So, you know, they're not as regular as you think they are, but when they happen, that, you know, they can be huge. Another one, which again, this was iconic, was David Batty and Graham Lasso, lads. Do you remember that one?
Ooh,
yes,
I have seen that game.
Remember that? Yeah.
That's on
YouTube. That one.
They
both went for it because, you know, they both went for the same loose ball. A lot of people were creating rumours around that, saying it was this, that, and the other. But, you know, that's just frustration in a game. You know, it does happen. But yeah, I mean,
didn't expect it from Lasso, did you?
No, definitely not. Definitely not.
He was the posh little Guardian reader of the team.
He was, yeah, he was.
Wilder's, you know, Wilder's, you know, I know he's not your cup of tea. He's a character at the end of the day. You know, he wasn't great for Borough. But, you know, they say never go back. And, you know, this is probably a good example of it. You know, he's gone back to Sheffield United. You know, they were gone when he went back there. He's tried his best. It hasn't been good enough. It'll be interesting to see whether Wilder stays with him when they hit the Championship again. Be interesting to see where he goes. But yeah, unacceptable. Shouldn't happen. But, you know, these things do happen in football, sadly.
Yeah, well, it is obviously high stakes at Sheffield United and what it could cost them coming down to the Premier League. After getting promotion, I still think they will be a strong team in the Championship, although with Cameron Archer and the likes of that. McCaddy's been a shining light for them this season as well, but it does make for good football next season, lining up against Middlesbrough again in the Championship. Will those teams be able to bounce back? Because that seems to be what you do. You seem to get up to the Premier League, spend all your money, and then become a bit of a yo-yo club. But it will be interesting to see how the likes of Burnley, Sheffield United, you would think Luton probably as well, maybe Everton or Nottingham Forest once they face FFP, potentially coming down to the Championship next season. And I like what, you know, Kieran Scott had to say, then potentially next season is going to be a little bit easier in the Championship with the teams that are coming down from the Premier League. Anyway, it's time for some morning ads. It is 20 past 8 here. Good morning on the North East Brekky Show. We'll be back right after this to talk about the Liverpool-Chelsea Carabao Cup final.
Why do clients choose Ather & Co?
Very diligent, very caring, put themselves in my shoes.
Always informed me, kept me up to date of what was going on.
Didn't feel I had anything to worry about, and I had nothing to do other than turn up for a medical. Ather's did the rest.
For the full story, see ather's.co.uk/reviews.
Choose the one you know, Ather & Co.
Hi, it's Bernie Slavin. Looking forward to being on every Monday on The Red between 6 and 7. Opinions, views, I don't want any BS.
We need to get their lottery numbers for Wednesday night, I think, or Saturday, definitely.
If Borough's 1-0 up and yous all do what you're going to do and end up getting beat 2-1, are you going to take any responsibility for that?
Regardless of what happens in the game, it needs to be done just to make a point. That's the point of it. The protest is supposed to be disruptive. It's supposed to get our voice heard.
No messing about. Let's get to the nitty-gritty. This Monday, 6 o'clock to 7, please join us up the Borough.
Slaven Live with the Dovecart. Spend your evening in the best bar in Teesside.
The tune, the red and the cut.
We're back, boys.
Welcome back to the North East Brekky Show. We're going to talk about that Liverpool-Chelsea. We did cover it in the first hour, but I just want to get the lads, because we had Ted having a few mic issues. WhatsApp!
We've got a couple of WhatsApps in. First and foremost, one winging its way in from Thailand. Hello, guys. Well done, Rye, for managing to do the Borough headlines after that dreadful performance from the team.
Let's hope the performances
will be better at Stoke. Keep up the great show, guys. Up the Borough. Bam. And then a second line saying, thank you for the birthday wishes, guys. Up the Borough.
So that's happy birthday.
And we have a first-time messenger coming in. Loving the show, lads, as always. Hard job after this weekend's football. I think Chris Wilder is a fantastic manager and just needs more time. Kind regards, Sandwich ID. Also, it should be Rooney for Sunderland, I think.
Yes, I agree.
Good morning, Jackie Lester. How are you?
He's hilarious, isn't he?
I did listen to Wayne Rooney on that overlap with Gary Neville, actually. He does feel hard done by, but Birmingham does old little Wayne. But let's talk about Liverpool v Chelsea, that Carabao Cup final yesterday. We saw an interesting game where we saw Liverpool inundated with injuries, fielding a very, very young outfit against Chelsea's billion-dollar team, and it was the young kids that got it done. Now, I think the biggest question for me is, does it underline Pochettino and what he has failed to do with all the $1 million of spending? Now, you would think that against a team like that, it's quite an embarrassing result. It's a billion-dollar team's losing to a bunch of 18, 17-year-olds. I mean, it's no disrespect there, but it really was. It wasn't a full-strength Liverpool outfit, and they still couldn't get the job done. Pochettino, after the match, said, I need to feel the pain. And we played for a trophy, and we didn't get it. Now it's the same. What can you tell me to feel better? No, nothing. I won't feel better for a long time. We also saw Pochettino post-match not shaking the hand of owner Todd Bowley. He walked past him in what we think was another Dan Neal gate. Hey? We've got Beal sacked. Will it get Pochettino sacked? Ted, your make of the game. And I guess the question that I want to ask both of you lads, all three of you lads, really, is this the end of Pochettino?
Hey, stop with me, are you?
Well, he's... we're
gonna, left it open.
Either one of us. Did I say Ted?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. Either one. Go on, Teddy boy.
What, Steve on a point? No. Steve first, go on.
Oh, you're far too polite. God,
this is really good, isn't it? This morning, what a great show.
so slick. Sorting awards are teeming through the door.
They are, yeah. I mean, look, he's gone into the club, hasn't he? And it's a mess of a club to start with. You know, they've spent £1 billion more or less on this team. I mean, Casadio yesterday, £115 million for him, really?
Yeah.
I'm not being funny, but they're a million miles away from competing for Champions League and Premier Leagues, I just think that Todd Bowley has come in and has no understanding of the Premier League, and the blame lies at his feet. I'm still not convinced that that the previous owner has got nothing to do with the club. That's my opinion, my theory. I still think it's some way, shape or form, if the war in the Ukraine, which is now into its second year, ever came to an end, that we might see some kind of return of the previous owner, in some way, shape or form. But it's just all very, very strange. It really is. And Pochettino really never stood a cat in hell's chance of going in there and changing anything, because it's a mess. It really is. Financial fair play, surely to God there has to be something on the horizon for Chelsea. You can't tell me you can spend that amount of money when you're not the biggest revenue-making team in the world or in the Premier League. I just think they're cruising for a huge fall. And Pochettino never had the opportunity. He was never going to have an opportunity to turn it around. You've got a bunch of individuals in that team who just can't play together. And I'm not sure how you change that. I'm not even sure Pep Guardiola could change that, because he is the best manager in the Premier League. I don't see how it could be done. So the answer is, I think he'll be gone. I think he'll be gone at the end of the season. Will the dare go back for Tuchel? Would they try and get him to come back and give it another go? Mourinho for another spell in the dugout at Chelsea.
Yeah, true.
You know, they're two big names that are available. You know, we know Alonso's, you know, going to be leaving and, you know, potentially going back to Liverpool, but, you know, he's got other suitors. There's going to be a merry-go-round of managers again. But, you know, why don't Chelsea take a punt on Wayne Rooney? I mean, you know, he's got Premier League class written all over him. Give him a go, Ted.
Yeah. I don't think anybody's
keep him away from Sunderland.
Yeah, well, yeah. That's a scary thought. I don't think they would go for Wayne Rooney. Then, yeah, the Sunderland we're talking about, never rule anything out. But Chelsea, I'm almost going to defend them a little bit here. First of all, I mean, Gary Neville calling them billion-pound bottle jobs on live TV is massively disrespectful, lad. That is hugely disrespectful. For somebody who was lucky at Man United that he was probably the only right back they had at the time. He's got away with a living, hasn't he? He's good entertainment value as a pundit, but calling them that, that's just like, I don't know, it's a bit snaky behaviour, especially when it's Liverpool involved, who's won, who's supposed to be his sworn enemy. I don't know if that was a bit of a north and south thing, I don't know, but I just found that it was a little bit crass, the comment, like, but Chelsea, and Steve's kind of alluded to it, they're a team, well, they're not just a team that's in transition, they're a whole club that's in transition. It's a new ownership, it's a completely new squad, it's a new manager, and you can't expect overnight results with that. No matter how much money you throw at that problem, that is not going to be an overnight fix. That needs time. I think Pochettino is a good coach, but you know, what the conversation that needs to be had with the ownership as well, what's the time scale for this? What is realistic in your book of making Chelsea a top four challenging team again and a cup winning team? And the answer for me is, personally, I think it's going to take at least another two seasons before they're up there. And that's if they keep that squad together. Yes, there'll be a couple of ins, a couple of outs, but you can't just throw a group of people together and expect them to perform brilliantly. Look at us.
Hey, this morning is perfect proof.
Great example this morning. Normally we're on fire, though. Obviously, I would never put us in that bracket, lads. But yeah, it's going to take time to fix the Chelsea issue. The worry is for them that other teams are starting to improve as well. You know, Newcastle, I guess you can throw into that, who are starting to improve. All right, they've had an up and down season this time around, but they'll learn from it. But then you look at the likes of Aston Villa, you look at those teams in and around that top six area are all improving. It's just going to take time for Chelsea to do that. I don't think swapping the manager is what they need to do right now. I think they need to keep that group of players together. They need to keep a very good coach in the job. There's no doubt in that whatsoever. Pochettino is a good coach.
But there's no doubt Pochettino's a good coach. There's no doubt the playing squad is a very good playing squad. So why isn't it working? Is it ego in the dressing room?
It's not a good playing squad. It's good individuals.
Well, that's what I'm on about. I'm talking about the squad. I'm not talking about how they're performing at the moment, because we know they're subpar at the moment. So what is missing?
The money he spent, they should have won last night. I'm sorry, they should have. They should have beaten. Liverpool were very, very, very undermanned last night. They had, you know, 20-year-olds out there, and Chelsea should have gotten a result from that last night. If any a chance
to Chelsea to win some silverware,
they should win it. Yeah, but you saw the Liverpool last night. I mean, there's no way Chelsea, with the money they had, the team that they put out there, should have lost to that Liverpool side. And I think that's the biggest sort of question mark over it for me.
Load of kids, you know, beat them. I mean, it's as simple as that. No wonder Jurgen Klopp was jumping up and down and going absolutely mental.
You could see the reaction from Enzo Fernandez to the Liverpool fan who taunted him, couldn't you?
Exactly.
I mean, you could just see the frustration among the players.
Yeah, I think Poch gets a sack as well, because I reckon that you'll see a little bit more from that Todd Bowley sort of ignorant sort of walk past as well. You can't do that to the owner that's put a lot of money into the team as well. So, yeah, a lot more to watch there from Chelsea, but it was a game that Chelsea should have won for me. We have just hit your Spets headlines. We'll be back right after this with plenty more on the North East Brekky Show.
Together across the North East.
The Timbercat and the Red.
I've got to ask the question, guys. Is anybody here taking deep joy out of the ills of Chelsea or the ills of Sheffield United? Because I must admit, when that goal went in last night at Wembley, I jumped up and celebrated almost as much as I would jump up and celebrate at Borough Gump.
Really?
Yeah. I was quite happy Liverpool beat them. Delighted to have Liverpool beat them.
I wanted Liverpool to win it. I wasn't bothered about Chelsea at all. Like, I mean, it doesn't get to me that much. Sheffield United, I've got no malice towards them. I've been down there many times. The fans are spot on. It's South Yorkshire police that are absolute nightmares. The Chelsea Liverpool game, I wanted Liverpool to win because Liverpool's got a chance of winning the league, and it gives you that in the offset that Newcastle potentially get a decent run together and finish in a European spot. It gives Newcastle a chance. Had Chelsea won, it's one less place. So yeah, look, it meant nothing to me, and it's laughable that the Chelsea have spent all of that money on a bunch of individuals who can't play together. It very rarely happens that, because usually you spend that kind of money, you get something out of it.
It's
embarrassing, lads. The Chelsea fans, and the Chelsea fans looked sick as chips, but they must be so embarrassed with the way that the club's going at the moment after having a period of not domination, but they did well. Champions League wins, FA Cup. Premier League, the John Terry Frank Lampard years were fantastic for them to watch, but they've hit the ground with a bump, and it's not very pleasant for them.
If that happened yesterday, do you think John Terry would have run on in his full kit trying to lift the cup?
Or that guy who used to go on as a look at, remember the guy who used to invade the pitch with just wearing very
Man United fan.
He was a Man United fan, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was funny. That's right.
It's crazy.
Do you think it's a case with Chelsea, though, that they've it's too many players in such a short space of time? Because obviously, they've rebuilt the squad. There's virtually nobody left from the last cup-winning side, let alone title-winning side. It's a case where they've just bought too many players to be able to gel them in such a short space of time. Because normally, if you spend big, you buy a star player, don't you?
Haven't watched them a lot this season. They've been on TV quite a bit, despite them not doing well, they're just lacking a centre forward, really. They play some pretty football, they play some decent football, but they haven't got anybody who can score goals. They haven't got one player who scores 20 goals a season. And, even Newcastle's got that. They've got players who are getting 10 goals in midfield and strikers who are capable, if they're not injured, of getting 15 to 20 goals a season. But Chelsea don't have that. They're relying on young players to come good and to score goals, and may well happen in the future. We get the experience under the belt, and then they hit a run. But that's where they've lacked. They haven't gone out and spent their money on an Osherman or whatever. And you would have thought with the money that they've got and the money that they've spent that they would have gone and invested in a good centre forward. But they haven't. So that's where they need to get. That's where they need to improve. They just don't score the goals. It's a strange situation. It really is. As I say, I'm not convinced on the ownership. I was never convinced that Todd Bowley was coming in was outright. I almost feel, and again, my opinion, not the radio stations. I feel he's a front man. I feel he's a front man for the club. And yes, on paper, contractually, I got no doubt that he's the owner, but I still believe that behind the scenes, I still think there's other people pulling the strings, and I think that's part and parcel why we see a little bit of an issue developing at Chelsea. But it'll all come out in the wash, as my mum used to say.
Certainly will. It certainly will. Lads, we've got to talk, Ted, obviously, just quickly about that result on Friday night for the Championship. Leeds absolutely battering Leicester 3-1 at home. Leeds making it a very big push now for that second place between Southampton, Leicester, you would think, are still safe in that top spot. But it was an interesting result for me. It's now two losses on the bounce for Leicester, obviously losing to us, and now Leeds. Leeds then move up to second. Ipswich as well, moving up to third because Southampton lost on the weekend as well. So the battle for that top two seems to be still wide open in that sort of, in I guess, for that Leicester, Leeds, Ipswich, Southampton sort of battle. You would think West Brom are too far away in 11 points, maybe 13 games to go. I just think it's between Southampton, Ipswich, Leeds and Leicester. But interesting result on Friday night, Teddy boy.
Yeah, it was. A few people would have saw that one coming. And Leicester just starting to have a little wobble, aren't they? Two defeats in the last five as well, in a row as well. Leeds are just absolutely romping home. I mean, everybody's thinking, oh, well, Leicester are far gone now. It's 6 points now, the difference between first and second. And Leeds, at this moment in time, are just in really, really banging form, aren't they?
They really are.
A tight end of the season, whichever way we look at it. I watched the West Brom Hull City game as well. That was the early kickoff on Saturday. Yeah. Hard-fought game. A little bit of a drab affair, to be honest, like, but there was more about Hull City than there was about West Brom, I think. Now, the result obviously suited West Brom going to Hull and getting a 1-1 draw. But, yeah, there was kind of nothing in those performances from those two teams where I thought, well, yeah, they stand out and they're guaranteed to be in the playoffs. I didn't see that, and this is absolutely wide open. Even the top end as well. Southampton have come unstuck a little bit, but who have they got next? 2 seconds. I did have that up. I don't know. It's not.
Great prep.
It was going
to
be
great prep.
Just adds to the
unique
show that was. It's adds to the unique show we've created today, lads.
For the way to Birmingham.
Yes, the way to Birmingham. Sorry. Yes. Yeah. We've got them coming up in 3 games' time as well. So obviously Southampton will probably be back on form then. They'll be wanting to give us a bit of a hide after we drubbed them 5-0. So yeah, we never ever do well. I think it was our record Premier League defeat was down at Southampton, and we scored something like 2-1 goals in that game as well. Santiago Virginie actually scored an absolute blinder of an own goal in that one, best one I've ever seen. So yeah, Southampton can look forward to getting on form with that one. It's just too close to call. I honestly think Leicester, they could slip. Leeds could go up as champions, you know. They're absolutely smashing everybody at the moment.
Yeah, my mate Andrew, I bumped into yesterday on my way back home, is delighted. He's a big Leeds fan, and he was over the moon with the result of the weekend. But yeah, it's wide open at the top, and I've got an illegal wazza.
An illegal wazza.
It's just been sent to me. It's been sent to me, not the official
It's been sent to Steve from Mr. S. Wraith.
Yeah.
Steve A. Steve, good morning. He says, for the morning show, lads, to ponder, Jesse Marsh would be a perfect fit for Sunderland or Borough. Brought up in the Red Bull management camp, so understands the philosophy of growth through trading to supplement low budgets. Did okay during his spell at Leeds in difficult times following Bielsa. Still believes they would have stayed up if they kept him and not bowed to media pressure, stirring up supporters' fears. Works on stats, percentages and developing youth, having had the experience of the US Soccer League system. He's the PR man's dream. And if you can get over the intensity of American soccer speak of grids and goalminders, he's full of self-belief.
Oh, he'd be going for headshots into the upper 90.
Yeah, what do you think then? What do you think?
He'd be standing on the sideline going, shoot that puppy.
Now, we've got ads to get to, but just quickly for Borough, I still think Michael Carrick is the best man in charge for Borough.
Yeah.
I don't see any, even though we're having probably a torrential sort of shocking end to the season, Michael Carrick's still the best manager for Borough at the moment. He's got a fantastic resume. He's got a lot to prove. And he just needs the backing from recruitment. But for me, Michael Carrick is still my main man. I absolutely love him. And I think he's got a fantastic future. And I think we need to stick by him in these times, like we stuck by him in the nice times at the end of last season. We just need to get the recruitment right and give him the players and the force, because we know what he can do, like last season when he has got the recruitment behind him.
And I'll let you into a little secret. You know, he loves what he's doing here. He won't have enjoyed the weekend. He does really like what he's doing here. He enjoys his relationship with Gibbo. He loves his relationship with the fans. His only fear is the fans turn on him due to, you know, performances, lack of points gathering on the pitch, and he doesn't want the fans to turn on him. So he loves what he's doing here, Carrick. And do you know what? if we didn't pick, well, no, that's going to be a little bit of a faux pas if I say that. If we finish no higher than we are this season, I still would want Michael Carrick in the job next season. I really would.
Yep, I completely agree. Yeah, I completely agree. And I don't know, what did you say, Teddy boy? Would you have Jesse Marsh?
Absolutely not.
Great kick save by the keeper.
You talk about the Red Bull camp. I don't care if he's from the Sitting Bull camp, mate. He's not for us.
And by the way, boys, here's one to ponder. Here's one to ponder when we're going to earn a few pennies, but here's one to ponder. I think now the promotion playoff race has really narrowed in just in the last two weekends. I think anybody below Coventry in ninth is out. And that includes your boys, Ted. I'm sorry. I think it's now ninth through to fifth for those two places. All right, boys. We'll be right back with more footy chats.
Right back. We'll be right back.
Indeed.
Have you fancied presenting your own radio show? Well, you could well be presenting this very programme. How do you fancy joining a growing list of fantastic radio presenters?
I don't want to hear, after four or five games in, the manager ever saying we need to restart and reboot.
This early days. The cup run.
The Cat is all about Wearside, and at times the Black Cats too. The Tune is all about Tyneside, and at times Newcastle United too. The Red is all about Teesside, and at times the Borough too. So come on, if you're confident you could present this very show, reach out, get in touch. Email any of the three stations, that's hello@thetuneuk.com, hello@thecatuk.com, or hello@theredUK.com.
Hey, what are you doing after breakfast Monday to Friday? Why not join me, Daz, across the North East for our mid-morning show, full of expert analysis?
This Sunderland squad is the youngest squad that the Championship has ever seen.
Top banter.
I've been looking at trains many minutes with my fans. It's an hour and 3 minutes. That's all it takes to get yourselves up here and see some real football.
And the quiz that is sweeping the nation, name that theme. How many will you get? He's always on the scene.
Fireman Sam.
And his engine's bright and clean. Join me, Daz, right here, every weekday morning from 9 till 11.
You know, I love this banter because this is what the Red, the Cat and the Toon's all about.
The Red, the Toon and the Cat.
Oh, boys, almost welcome time for Dazzy, but he's not here yet.
Yes. Ah, no bacon buddies in the office as at the moment, but to tell
How's
you
the
what,
bacon, did you see?
There's been enough... There's enough Steve bacon Bruce, going around this go. Morning.
Sunderland manager.
No, Steve, calm down. We know you're listening, mate. Calm down. All right, just take a breather. We're not that bad. We might have all lost on the weekend, but we're not in the Steve Bruce territory just yet. We've got to just quickly wrap up this playoff talk. I just wanted to ask quickly of a question to Ted and Dave, and then I've got a question for Stevie about the injuries at Newcastle as well before we bring it home here on the North East Footy Brekky Show. The quick question I have for you, Ted and Dave, and I'll start with you, Ted, is that from a Middlesbrough point of view, in being in the playoffs or around that sort of area this season, I actually am sort of kissing the faith that we're not actually there because I feel like the battle between Leicester City, Leeds, Ipswich and Southampton is not one that Middlesbrough could have competed with. Now, obviously, if we were up there, we would have been doing well, but I still think it's a very, very three-horse race in between those three Premier League teams. Obviously, Ipswich doing remarkably well. They've obviously spent big money, but I feel like that push for Borough would have been a bit too much in terms of trying to keep around there. We would have seen probably big money thrown around in January and all that sort of stuff. And I just don't think it's one that... I mean, the battle last season for me to go up was a lot better and closer than it would have been this season, if that makes any sense. Are you on the same page from Sunderland point of view?
Yeah, to be honest, I mean, it's when you start the season and you think, like, sort of on the basis of getting into the playoffs last time around, the objective is to either do the same again, repeat that form, or go one better. And I think everybody has been kind of found wanting by those sides that are in the top three positions at this moment in time. They are not miles and miles ahead, but they're a good proportion ahead of what everyone else is doing. Southampton, you could almost put them in that bracket, although their form is a little bit topsy-turvy. You know, they're capable of great football on one day, then they're capable of getting beat 5-0 by Sunderland the next. So they've always got that in them, I suppose. Yeah, we're going to have to start all over again. We're going to be starting again without the likes of Jack Clark. So I think, you know, where we are around about now, 10th, we'll probably finish in and around that position. If we can get any higher, then great. But yeah, we'll finish around then. You've just got to consolidate, start building for the future. Obviously, you know, you look at players like Romain Mundell who've been brought in. I guess that's, you know, there's your Jack Clark replacement. That's what we're getting. Whether they reinvest any of that transfer money that we'll undoubtedly get for Jack Clark in the summer, we need to invest that wisely to turn ourselves into at least playoff contenders for next season. Because a third season of nothing and you know, not at least getting to a playoff final, that starts to look like the club is stagnating again. And they need to push. And Middlesbrough, in exactly the same position, Middlesbrough need to push up the league as well and get through and get into the Premier League, because all the time we're down there, we are losing out and we are slipping further and further behind what is already a massive gulf in class to the Premier League.
What do you reckon, Dave? I was just saying that obviously Ted kind of agrees as well that it is a bit of a three-horse race, but I do get his sentiment in terms of us falling further down the ladder, but I still think Middlesbrough weren't geared up this season to have a push to compete with the likes of the three teams that came down.
We lost 45 million quid's worth of attacking talent last year, and we didn't replace it like for like. So, you know, we're in a development phase, we're in a growth phase as far as the players, a young squad of players, a bit like Sunderland. I am so pleased we're not there now, because for a number of reasons, and it'll sound really strange saying we're not on the coattails of the playoffs, because it adds extra pressure. Because the focus has to be, can we make it for the end of the season? Can we make it for the end of the season? Our squad right now is not developed enough, is not good enough for promotion. So I think we should get that, you know, I'm so pleased we can get the words promotion out of our heads. Because can you imagine what would happen to the Borough if they somehow managed to make their way into the Premier League through the playoffs? We would be right back down, tail between our legs, record points in terms of not being scored, tally for the end of the season. We'd have been destroyed by the clubs. I'm really pleased this season we're not there. As for the playoffs and just having a bit of a brief flirtation with them at the end of the season, again, I think that brings extra pressure. And it brings frustration, because when you're in and thereabouts and within touching distance, you agonise over every single point dropped. Every defeat is like an open wound. And I think we can finally put that to bed this season and say, right, let's use the rest of this season to develop what we've got, to identify what we need. And Middlesbrough Football Club, if you're really going to have a go and give Michael Carrick the tools to do what he needs to do next season, it starts now. It starts looking at what young players can come through. It starts looking at tactics, what formations we can get away with. Who might be that hidden gem in the current squad that's being played slightly out of position? We talk a lot about Force coming into a more central role because he's being played out wide, etc. Now's the time you can experiment. I firmly believe those teams who are on 44 points, and there's a glut of them, there's about five of them there in the table, and Sunderland on 47, that's your mid-table. Now, I know Borough's only 9 points away from a relegation scrap. That's not going to happen. That's enough of a cushion right now to make sure we can go out there and we can see the season out. So there's nothing now to play for other than let's get it right for next year. That's where I stand.
Yeah, I'd like to see a bit more from Law McCabe and the AJ Matthews and stuff like that for the Borough now. Because obviously the playoffs are just, you know, they're a bit too far and out of reach.
They're 11 points
away. Steve, I wanted to... Yeah, it's too much.
We're closer to the 12 points, in effect, because we've got a terrible goal difference. You know, that's massive. To catch up on teams who are in winning runs of form.
Yeah, and we're not ready. You know what I mean? That's the thing. We're not ready. I just don't feel last season when we had those players and the depth that we did, I felt we could have gone up and maybe Michael Carrick could have kept the Archers, the Gileses, all that together and maybe put together a bit of a team for a push then. But this season, I just don't feel like we're ready. I feel like we need another sort of summer, bit of a rebuild, get some strikers in, cover up all those injuries that we had, and give me more of a sense of squad depth and stuff like that. But you're absolutely right. It does start now. Steve, before the end of the show, I just wanted to come back to you with Newcastle and those injuries that have taken a toll for you this season. We saw on the weekend, obviously, your loss to Arsenal. But you have gotten, obviously, some players back. I just wanted to ask you, in terms of the injuries, because it hasn't really been to the defensive side except for Nick Pope. Obviously, you know, losing to Arsenal 4-1, is there a significant injury there that you can think has really derailed it? Is it a Joe Linton or something that could have maybe turned the tide? Or is it a lack of recruitment against Arsenal there that you could have seen? I mean, I'm just wondering with the state of injuries going through it. Defensively, I mean, there's not many missing. I'm just wondering if there's anyone there that you can put it down to not being there that could have gotten a different result out of the Arsenal game.
Yeah, you nailed it with Joe Linton, really. He's been a key, you know, key player for Newcastle since Eddie Howe came in. And, you know, missing him down that left-hand side has, you know, it has massively affected us. But, is you know, that means, what, we're a one-player team? Of course it doesn't. We should be looking at, you know, we should be looking at how you counteract, you know, Joe Linton missing from the team. We shouldn't be scrabbling around, you know, when he's injured and saying, well, hold on a minute, you know, where do we plug this gap? But yeah, it does appear that the Joe Linton injury was the biggest one, and Nick Pope, because Nick Pope was our goalkeeper, you know, last season with that back four, and it just seems that Dubravka coming in, you know, it changed things for the back four, you know, behind them as well. So in front and behind, two big players missing, and two players which affect the game massively for Newcastle, and suddenly, you know, the back four seems to be, you know, leaking goals like they're going out of fashion. Botman certainly hasn't come back from his injury, the same player. And, you know, we know that there was issues. You know, he spoke out about, you know, having a setback, and that was down to, you know, something that happened, you know, at the club, which clearly was, you know, annoyed enough to speak out about it. And, you know, with Joe Linton out and Pope out, and then Botman not playing to the same standards as he was last season, has he recovered properly? Who knows? That's your issue. It's as simple as that. And then, you know, the lack of midfield players in general that we've had available over the course of the last 2 or 3 months, you're relying on a 17-year-old who's done a great job, to, you know, to do the job of a seasoned pro, a professional. So it all adds up. But, you know, you can't be making excuses. Newcastle are where they are in the league, you know, and rightly so. You know, that's where we deserve to be. I think if we do get European football this year, you know, we'll be lucky. And if we do get it, we need investment. Lack of investment in the January transfer window has also hampered us. You know, the fact that we are, you know, beset with FFP angst every time there's a window open, you know, and then it leads to, you know, not bringing any players in when it's quite clear we need players in, doesn't help either. So it's a multitude of things. It's a multitude of things. And, you know, whatever happened in the dressing room in December, whatever happened to the confidence, and was it down to the injuries? Was it down to something that had gone off the pitch for one or two of the players? You know, again, we don't know. But there's been lots of different reasons why Newcastle United haven't been the same team as they were last year. I don't buy into this, we overachieved last year. You know, we deserved to finish fourth. We deserved to qualify for the Champions League. We deserved to get to Wembley. You know, you don't become a bad team overnight. Have Newcastle been found out by some of the other teams in the Premier League? You know, and people have been studying them over the summer. There's lots of things that you could suggest might have happened, but I think it's just an accumulation of things, lads. It's as simple as that. Not, you know, it's not the end of the world, but, you know, to go from a team chasing Champions League to relegation form, which is what we've currently got at the moment. Not that we're going to get relegated, but, you know, the form that we've got in the form table is we're fifth bottom in, you know, since December, in form alone. So, yeah, it's been tough to take. But I guess, you know, Tuesday night is make or break. We win against Blackburn, get into the quarterfinals, get a home draw, and then, you know, things might look a bit brighter by the time we get towards the weekend.
Okay, yeah. Fingers crossed. Morning, Daz.
Good morning, gents. How are we doing?
Morning, Daz.
Morning.
He's still all bunged
what
up.
What a weekend, mate. Hey, what a weekend. Feeling any better?
Yeah, a little bit better. Steve, are you doing
sure
all right?
I'm sure the Borough made you feel better.
Thanks, Daz. A little bit better. Yeah, I had to go and work at the weekend. You've just got a crack on, Daz. That's the thing. That's, like, you and I are just old troopers, mate.
Yeah.
Super steady. Troopers.
Steady with the old. Super troopers. But yeah. Yeah, what a disappointing weekend, but it's a new week, and here we go again. We start again. We pick ourselves up, and we dust ourselves down and we...
And start all over again.
Oh. Yeah, well, we have no other options, do we, really?
Okay, then. Right. Yeah, you're not wrong.
What? Who? What?
Who shows it? I thought you said start again.
What have you got on this morning, Daz?
Well, we've got our new Music Monday panel this morning, listening to three new releases from Paul Weller, Selena Gomez, and the Kings of Leon. And we've also got
Daz, yeah? What have you got on?
Right. wouldn't you like to know?
I think we've reached the end of this particular episode.
Yeah. What was that quote? I've got £1 undies and 50 pence of them are up me. We've got lowering the tone. I'm still on your show, so I'm all right. We've also got a brilliant guest on this morning, Bill Ward. Bill was in Coronation Street a few years ago, played Charlie Stubbs, the builder. He's appearing in the full Monty this week at Newcastle Theatre Royal. So we're chatting to Bill as well this morning. So, and of course, the quiz that is sweeping the nation.
I wonder if you're doing the full Monty on stage, do you get your kit off? Can you ask him that one for us?
I could ask him,
it might increase the sales from the women's perspective.
He did say there was a big climax at the end, so I'm assuming that, you know. I'm sorry. Again, I'm on your show, so hey.
That's a total partridgeism, isn't it?
It really is.
See you, boys.
Have a good one.
See you, lads. See you tomorrow. Have a great Monday. Bye.
Truth is bulletproof, there's no fooling you. I don't dress the same. Me and true, you say I was yesterday. I've gone our separate ways. Left my living fast somewhere in the past, cause that's for chasing cars. Turns out open bars lead to broken hearts. I'm going way too far.